Good morning, Jake's house. Go ahead and make your way up to the front. We're going to let our fires burn bright and thaw each other out this morning as we worship.
Well, this song is prophetically called You Make Me Brave, because y'all braved the snow to get here.
That's right.
Majesty and wonder of you, O King of heaven, humility.
many just sense a sweet, sweet presence of the Lord? Wow. Well, the Lord has made all of you brave today. You are all very brave to get out there on those roads and come and worship. And I just, you know, since we're just doing one service today, I don't think we should be in a hurry. I know we don't have a full worship, quote, team, but you're all here, so we have full worship. Yeah. Yeah. So we're here to worship the Lord, and there's some things that are on my heart, and I want to share a little bit more, you know, from last week, but I just really sense just a sweet presence of the Lord, and we just want to take advantage of this opportunity here to worship today. And you know, I think God has made this day a special day. How many believe that God's made this day a special day? And so, let's just, matter of fact, maybe some of you, not since you braved the weather, maybe some of you that would normally, you know, not come to the altar and worship, maybe you would brave the altar and come on down here and worship with Pastor Terry and myself here in the front row. And matter of fact, if we can get the lights, Joe, and close those doors, and let's just really take some time to just worship the Lord today. Josh, thank you for being here. I thought it was Bjorn that was supposed to be here, but Bjorn, he must be stuck up there somewhere. Robin, thank you for being here. And you're all by yourself, Mary. Mr. Dennis, thank you. Thanks for being here. Come on, let's just raise our hands and worship. Robin, can we just sing that chorus again? Thank you.
speaking of water, I want to say let it rain, but it's almost like let it snow right now.
Across this nation, let it
Your presence is all I need. All I need. Oh, I need thee. Oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace to thee.
no other friend. There is no other friend like you, oh Lord. No other brother, no other sister like you. There is no other love. There is no other love like you, oh Lord. No other sweeter, no other fountain but you.
Sing it again to a church.
There is no other friend. There is no other friend like you, oh Lord. No other brother, no other sister like you. There is no other love. There is no other love like you. Fountain but you. Touch of your garment, Lord. Then how much more of your love is for me than I'm tasting, Lord. Draw me, take me,
Come on, we're going to sing that again. That my fountains are in you. Because our strength is in the King. Come on, our strength, my source of strength is in God. And some of us need to hear that prophetically this morning, that He is our strength. And if we're feeling drained and frustrated and angry, and the X that marks the anchor of our life is gone, hey, listen, today is a good day to reset and make God the anchor of your life. So come on, let's just sing that and sing it with us, you guys. Let's sing it out to the King this morning.
And all the fountains are in you.
Listen, I'm excited because you're here today on Snowmageddon. And listen, gratefully I live where I live that I can get out. Because yesterday me and some friends helped a young lady that's dealing with drugs and helped her get her to a treatment facility. And you know, everyone that's dealing with drugs has the same story. They just feel like everything's lost, everything's gone. And we always tell them, no, it's always regainable. So I'm going to tell you, and I'm going to pray this over your life today, over your finances, over your marriage, over your friends, your situation, your medical report. It's never over till it's over. Come on. So come on, pray with me, you guys. Father, we thank you this morning that you are the source of our strength. Father, we thank you for the homeless people that are around here right now. We pray blessing and faith upon them. Father, we pray a turnaround in their lives. Father, we pray for every marriage that is broken today. We pray for every financial situation that's overbearing. For every person that is frustrated and stressed out in work. That, Father, today is a turnaround day. Father, we thank you that today you are the source of our strength. Come on, no weapon formed against us will prosper. If God is for us, who can be against us? Father, we thank you this morning. We thank you this morning, God, that you are declaring from your throne room a yes and an amen over our lives. Father, we thank you that your voice is thundering from your throne room over our lives right now. Come on, over our families, over the Pacific Northwest. Come on, we thank you right now, God. We thank you, God. Come on, just exalt the Lord right now. Just thank him. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Come on, the Bible says that God goes out against your enemies at the beat of your worship. So, Father, we thank you that as we worship and celebrate you right now, God, that you are overcoming everything. Come on, he's overcoming everything. Come on, isn't that amazing? God didn't panic during Snowmageddon. Pastor Keith and I were praying for snow. What did you think was going to happen? Come on, let's just honor the Lord this morning. Come on, you guys, let's honor the King. Woo! It even snowed in Phoenix, Arizona. Wow. Well, you can have a seat for a minute. Listen, we're super excited that you made it here today, because today is a special day. So Joe, go ahead and turn some lights on. It is Journey Group launch today. So Michelle Brown, come on up here. Give her a big hand as she comes. Michelle oversees our small groups, our Journey Groups.
Wow. Good morning, good morning, good morning. We have new Journey Groups. We've got a whole bunch of them. If you're not connected, come and see us at the table. This is our soft kickoff, but a lot more showed up than we thought. So awesome. We're going to be set up the next Sunday as well. And the leaders that are leading groups, if you're here, could you stand up? There's not very many of us. So here they are. Here's some of our leaders. A lot of them couldn't get out of the snow. So hey, a big thank you. Come and see us at the table after service. We'll give you a new schedule. Hook up with somebody, get connected. Yeah.
And they're looking to start some new men's groups. So if you're interested in leading or co-leading one of those groups, make sure you go back to the Pink Connect banner and see Michelle and Jeremy right after the service. Amen? This is going to be good. Hey, let's just turn to the cameras. I want to thank all of our family that could not make it here today because of the weather, but they are watching online. So we want to thank them. We literally told everyone, if you can't be here safely, don't come. But you all said, we're coming because we're Jake's house. We're here anyway. It's all good. So let's just stand up. We're going to just spend a couple minutes greeting each other, give someone a hug, a high five, tell them you love them, tell them they're good and they're brave.
Ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. with angels and saints we sing worthy. Are you Lord? And you will be praised. You will be praised. With angels and saints we sing worthy. Are you Lord?
You right, all right. If everyone can make your way back to your seats. How's everyone doing this morning? A few hoots and hollers? All right, all right. Is anybody like me and really enjoy the snow? All right, all right. Is there any men here, or ladies, I don't want to discriminate, but it tends to be men that I have this conversation with. Anybody happen to go out maybe like Friday night really late and do some donuts and drive around a little bit? All right, all right. Where are you at? Give me a little wave. All right, come on. Did my roommate do that? I actually don't know. Probably. I think he did. I think he did. We both have Jeeps, and we might have had a little fun in the snow. Praise the Lord. Lord. Well, are you guys happy this morning? All right, all right, all right. My name's Kendall. Good morning. I'm glad that you're all here. We're going to put a slide up. There it is behind me. In just a few minutes, we're going to have an opportunity to give this morning, which honestly, like, I don't say this lightly. This is one of my favorite parts of service. I love giving. I love sowing into what God's doing, and I know that my life is blessed because of it. And that's good news. Amen. So there's just a few different ways we can do that around here. But before we get into all that and do that, if you are a guest with us this morning, I just want to say good morning, welcome, glad you're here, glad you made it through the snow. But if you want to, you can throw your hand up now and someone from our welcome team has a gift for you they'll bring to you, or you can meet us in the back at the Connect Center, find anyone with one of them pink vests like my man Jeremy or Michelle, she's back there, she's got a vest on. We just want to connect with you, get you connected to the church, let you know more information about us, and we just want to get to know you because we think that you're all awesome. Amen? So if you are, can we just celebrate everyone that's with us this morning and the guests that are in the house? Awesome, awesome. We are glad that you are here. We really believe that church is the best place to be on a Sunday morning. Not just Jake's house. I think you should just be in church. Amen? Awesome, awesome. Well, I'm up here because we're doing the offering. That's I'm just kidding. We actually are going to our youth winter camp in 5 days, I think. I don't know. Serious winter camp. I told everyone, I've been saying for months now, I've been praying, and we were going to have snow for 3 years. 3 years in a row it'd be now. People are like, Kendall, it's not going to snow. It's going to be the most mild winter. Shut up. It's snowing, baby. Come on now. We're going to have some fun. It's going to be incredible. I'm super pumped. We got a friend, Pastor Darren Stott. Any of you know who that is? Pastor Darren's going to be with us Friday night and Sunday night, and we're going to have an incredible time. So this is like the last possible moment for anyone to register. And so if you need some more information or know someone who needs to register and needs to be there, I'm going to be setting up a table back in the hub after service. Just come find me, talk to me. We'd love to give you some more information. But with that being said, we've had a bunch of students registering, and we've been so blessed to have a bunch of scholarships available for students, but I do have to say that we do need a few more scholarships. There's a few students who are wanting to go, and I've registered just in faith, knowing that God's going to provide, but we do need some more scholarships. So if God tugs on your heart at all in this morning, and you feel like you want to sow into that, sow into some lives being changed, if you want to give, just designate that it's for winter camp, scholarship fund, anything like that. It'll all go towards students getting to camp. You guys think that's a good idea? You guys think that's cool? I really have to say, how much is camp? Camp is $180. Covers we're there for three full days. It's 4 days, 3 nights. We're there. That covers meals, housing, all that kind of stuff. I'll make sure everyone gets back safely, probably. Just kidding. It's going to be a lot of fun. I do have to say, though, I've been in tears a couple times just thinking about how generous you guys all are as a church family and all the students that I can say yes to. seriously, thank you. Thank you. There's lives that are being changed because of your guys' generosity, because of your faithfulness to love. And I'm just a week ago having a conversation with one of our students' moms saying, like, this has been the hardest year of their lives as a family, and she's in tears telling me how much her daughter has changed. and how she's grown and how God has transformed her life in this last year. And that's because people have sowed and faithfully supported for our students to get to camp or go on missions trips or all these different things that they're able to do. And so thank you. Thank you, church family. You guys are incredible. So thank you. Thank you. Wow. It's snowing. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right. Well, offering team, if you guys would come forward, I just want to pray as we give this morning. I don't even really want to admit this, but I was watching Netflix the other day. I don't remember when it was. Do any of you watch anything? Okay, just me. All right. There's this show, Meat Eater, I think. It's like a hunting show. I don't even hunt. I don't know why I watch it. But he cooks, and I like cooking, I guess. But he was talking about trapping beavers. I don't know why I'm sharing any of this. Are you guys okay this morning? Okay. Are we having fun in church? All right. And he was talking about that what beaver trappers used to do is that they would trap beavers, but they would always make sure they left like stock, they would call it. That they would know that next year they could go back and trap in the same location and there would still be beavers there. They make sure they didn't over-trap something. And I felt like as I was actually driving here this morning, I felt like I was saying that our tithe is a lot like that, that we're leaving stock. That God, like, it's all God's anyways. And he's like, hey, I'm just asking for 10%. I'm just asking for first fruits of your life. And I promise that I'll bless you out of that. And that, like, to me, my tithe is I'm leaving stock in my life, knowing in faith that God is going to provide for me, bless me, cover me, be there with me, amen, that I don't have to worry about anything because I've got stock with Jesus, and that's the best place, amen? So just as we give this morning, I just wanted to encourage you with that. Like, let's just give in faith, knowing that, hey, I got a good God, and he loves me, and he's got my back, amen? Amen, is that good news? All right, are we ready to give this morning? All right, let's pray. Father, I thank you for all that you are. I thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness to our lives. God, I thank you for the beautiful snow. I thank you that we could all gather here this morning and worship together and be as a family. God, I pray that you would bless every single person in this place. God, I just release breakthrough in families and in finances. God, whatever is needed in this house this morning, God, I'm asking that you would provide for every single one of those things. God, we thank you for it. God, I pray that this winter camp with our youth students would be the best ever. I pray that it would transform and change every single one of our lives. God, that we would come back different. God, I pray that you would have your way in all of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Awesome. Well, we have an update video for you all if you'd turn your attention to the screens behind me.
Knocks out even the toughest weeds fast.
One, two, three, it's over!
All right. Don't be a bystander. Amen. Amen. Do call the church, though, and find out how we're open this week and the next week, though. And so we will be adjusting possibly our schedule. So we have three schools, our prayer school, as you just saw, and our discipleship school and our leadership school. And so we might be adjusting our schedule this week. So call the office, and we'll give you some information on that. All right. Well, good morning, family. Good morning. Man, look at all the people here that brave the weather. Come on, this is awesome. So much fun. So much fun. Friday, you know, it snowed again, and I was down Thursday and Friday down in Seattle at Pastor Darren Stott's Seattle Revival Center, and hanging out with Darren and Charlie Champ and Patricia King. And Patricia had just a great word that she brought, and then she also prophesied over myself, and we just had a great time together for a couple days, and it was a lot of fun. But I had, it was probably, what, 5 days ago, 6 days ago, I woke up in the morning, and all of a sudden it hit me. I'm like, I wonder if my passport is like, you know, expired, yeah. And because Carmen and I are flying out in 2 days for Mexico. And we've been doing Mexico trips for 25 years, but this will always been missions. This will be our second time for vacation. And so we were just like so excited. And all of a sudden, I was just like, oh my gosh, my path. And my honey's like, oh no, it's probably June or something like that, you know. And I'm like, I don't know, I better take a look. Come to find out that my passport expired this Tuesday, the day we're leaving? Okay. So anyway, so I get it all scheduled, go down on Thursday, you know, to get my new passport. Everything's together. Everything's in order. The problem is because I live within a 100-mile radius, they require a 24-hour gap. So even though they could have processed it that day, they asked me to come back the next day. So no problem, perfect. It was all arranged. I'm already down in Seattle. I'm staying down there for the conference. Friday morning after Patricia ministers, I head down to Seattle, Fifth Street, and it started snowing an hour early. I'd been watching the forecast. It was supposed to start at 1, and it started at 12, and it was pandemonium in Seattle. People were like freaking out, and I'm trying to get in, and everybody's trying to get out. And so I get to the passport agency office. Oh, we're sorry, they closed 3 hours ago because of the storm. I'm like, what? So anyways, it was totally miraculous. The Lord ended up navigating me. It's a whole kind of crazy story how I ended up getting on the express lanes, and it was just completely wild. And anyways, I probably saved myself 2 hours. So got home, and of course, you know, Friday, as you guys know, was just awesome, awesome snowstorm. And then Carmen and I, we had a couple meetings, and we met some people for dinner, and it was all good. And then we come home, and my honey gets her car stuck in the driveway. And our neighbor, you know, the next day we got her out. But I told my neighbor, I'm like, hey, you didn't know that you were going to be living on a ski hill, did you? Because we're up on a hill, and it is literally a ski hill right now. But we're having fun, and it's everybody's being safe. Everybody's being safe, right, and having fun? Okay, good. Good, good, good. Pray for Carmen and I. We're heading down to Seattle tonight, hoping that we can get an early flight out, and hoping that the passport agency will be open for a couple hours tomorrow. Otherwise, we don't know what we're going to do. They have my old one, and so I don't know what's going to happen. We've been totally at peace, trusting God. God's going to work this all out. I just believe that. You guys agree? God's going to get us out of here and stuff. Hey, Mike and Narina Lighty are in the house today. And, yeah. And Michael's 40th birthday yesterday. So stand up. Come on, Mike. Come on. Come on, happy, happy. Come on, give him a big happy birthday. Yeah. 40. 40.
What?
Oh, my goodness. Man, you're getting old.
Wow.
Oh, my gosh. So much fun. Hey, pray for Pastor Chuck. He had very successful surgery. Most of you know he injured himself in Africa, and so got an infection and that type of thing. And so he had surgery on Friday, and so the Thompsons, Shilsons visited him, what, yesterday? Is that right? And so hopefully they're coming home tomorrow. Is that correct? And so give him a visit, because he will be at home for quite a while, and so they would love some visits. So please visit them. They would greatly appreciate that. Also, continue to pray for Pastor Jeshu, Pastor Debbie, the whole crew, Ed and Kelly, as they're in India, and they've been doing some great things in India. And just had their big Kingdom Family Seminar and their big youth seminar. So continue to pray for them as God's just doing great things. Let's see, what else? So much good, fun stuff happening. Yeah. So pray for their safety as they come home and come back. We miss them. And we just pray safety over all the Jake's House family. Supposed to be snowing for a couple more weeks. let's pray for the youth camp this weekend. We want to pray that everything goes well with that, and everyone's safe, and we're able to get everybody there and stuff. So let's pray for these things. Father, we lift up Chuck and Patty. We pray for just your divine intervention and just supernatural healing and recovery for Pastor Chuck. God, we pray for Jeshu and Teresa. We pray just your continued covering over their team and all the ministry that's taken place and their travels, Father, in Jesus' name. God, we pray for the winter camp, Awaken. We pray, God, for all the worship, all the ministry, the preaching, Darren coming, how awesome, Destiny Life coming, doing worship, and Lord, all the youth that are coming and experiencing, Lord, your presence and encounter with you, God, lives change, forever changed, never be the same again. God, we pray for such a moving of your spirit, God, over these youth, Father, and Father, over this region. God, we're so hungry for you, we're so hungry for a move of your spirit. And so, God, we just thank you and we praise you. And, Daddy, help Carmen and I get my passport and help us get out of here safely in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Yeah, we were all excited. You know, we planned this trip, and so we're going to be celebrating my birthday. And so I got a birthday, too, coming. And then, yeah. Huh? 41, yeah, and stuff. So, and then also we're meeting some friends down there, and they're celebrating their anniversary, and so it'll be fun. Well, grab your notes, and we're going to pick up from last week, and I so appreciate, there was just a lot of feedback, and even on social media, I addressed the topic of abortion. And just our stance as a church family, and also just really want to get out there, I think, some truths that need to be properly communicated, and so we want to pick that up today. Holy Spirit, help me to share, Papa, your heart and heaven's perspective, Lord, and help us to convey, Lord, your love, your unfailing love, your love that covers our nation. And Lord, our nation, Lord, needs covering. And we just pray the love of God just cover our nation. God, that you would heal, continue to heal. Heal family in this community and in this region and Lord, across the land. In Jesus' name, amen. After both services last week, there were many people that came up after the service just in tears, and were just so touched, and many that just the shame and the guilt just being broken off, because as I shared before, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, and those that have participated in abortions, you know, the enemy has, you know, the problem with deception is it's really deceiving. And for any of us to ever judge someone that has fallen into sin is so ridiculous, because we've all fallen into sin and we've all had seasons of our lives where we've been in deception. And for anyone to point the finger about anything is just so wrong. And so the church should not be known for our condemning of others. The church should be known of our covering of others. That's what Jesus did, right? Yeah, Jesus covered. He didn't condemn. And as I shared last week, we actually lose our voice. We lose our voice when we condemn and we don't cover. And so it's so important that we really do cover. And there is warfare and there is a battle, and I'll get into that in a moment. But it's not with people. It's not with people. We'll grab your notes there. This is not your typical pastor response here concerning this subject. I'm not going to start in Psalm 139 as much as I love that scripture, and there's some great points. I think many have heard and understand and know that, life is at conception. And the Lord knew us long before even our parents even came together. God knew us. And so we know, and scripture is, there's much scripture concerning that. And so we, you know, Jesus came that we might have life and life to the fullest. And so Deuteronomy 30, the Lord says, life or death, blessing or cursing, you choose. And then the Lord says, choose life. So God is always, 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 always about choosing life. That's a good place for an amen. God is always saying, choose life. That's the decision that he always wants us to choose. He always wants us to choose life. There is some spiritual warfare that's going on in our country. It's quite obvious. And to think that things are just about abortion, it's so much more than that. Actually, there's a spirit in the world. It's an Antichrist spirit, and we're not afraid of the Antichrist. We're not saying the Antichrist is here or anything like that, or any one individual is the Antichrist. All that stuff will pan out. Okay, it's not, our focus is the kingdom of God. Okay, all that stuff is going to pan out. You say, are you Pastor Keith, are you pre-trib, post-trib, mid-trib? I'm pan-trib. It's all going to pan out. Okay, so it, our focus is the kingdom of God, and listen, we don't have to be afraid of the Antichrist, but the Bible is very clear. There's an Antichrist spirit, and the purpose of the Antichrist spirit in the earth, and eventually the Antichrist, to raise his ugly head, which will only be for a very short season, and Jesus is going to put him in his place. And so that's good news. The Bible is all good news. It's all good news. And from cover to cover. And so the Antichrist spirit, though, is all about a world government, world economic system, a world healthcare system, a world religious system. And so those things are going to rear its ugly head at times. And so, you know, whether it be abortion or the Green Deal or the gender issue I covered a little bit last week, you know, our worship, our freedom in worship, our freedom in speech, you know, all of these things will always, they're always being attacked. This is not anything new. And they'll continue to be attacked because there's an Antichrist spirit in the earth. So these things are always going to be. But right now, it's escalated more than ever. And there is some strong agendas that are happening right now in our nation that are coming against our freedoms. But what's even more disturbing in your notes here is, under that little line there where I have worship and speech, where the government is wanting to control. I'm not talking about just, you know, I'm talking about issues of Antichrist government that want to come in through various different ways and different extremes. And what's most interesting is this, is now more than ever, even our own government, places of our own government, want to dictate what is moral. So, for example, you have a number of extreme Democrats. And I'm not looking, again, I've said this before, I'm not looking to be political. I'm not political. I'm kingdom. Okay? But I do believe it's important that you know where to place your vote, and you've done your homework, and you and everyone should vote because we all have a responsibility. But again, this is not a political moment here as I'm addressing this issue of abortion. But we will have to give an account. We will have to give an account. Does that make sense? Every one of us, we will have to give an account. And it really disturbs me that there are people from the radical left that would say a wall around borders, which, by the way, everybody believes in walls, and you don't have a nation if you don't have a wall and you don't have borders. You don't have a nation. And so it disturbs me that someone would say that a wall is immoral, but yet killing millions of innocent babies is moral. And the Bible talks about this in Isaiah chapter 5, verse 20, when there would be people in the last days that would call good evil and evil good. And so it's important. My point being is, there's a lot of this stuff that is really tied together. It disturbs me that people are attacking President Trump in such a way and throwing around impeachment and throwing around that because he's another Hitler. I'm thinking, you know, the very people that are calling him Hitler are slaughtering innocent, millions of innocent people. So, I mean, you know, and again, listen, the only reason I'm a Trump supporter is because the Bible says that we're supposed to pray for those in leadership. Okay, so don't give me any ugly stuff. Don't send any ugly stuff over the internet or anything like that. Well, you're just using the pulpit to be a Trump supporter. I'm using the pulpit to speak the truth. The Bible says that every Christian is supposed to pray for their leaders. We're supposed to pray for our leaders. We're supposed to pray for our leaders. Every Christian is supposed to pray. One day you're going to stand before God. Did you pray for your leader? Now, this is important, or leaders. You're either partnering with Satan, the accuser of the brethren, or you're partnering with Jesus, the high priest, that forever makes intercession for all people, because it's his will that none should perish. So this is in your Bible, Hebrews, and I've got the scriptures here. In Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, Jesus is forever making intercession for everyone on the planet because it's his will that none should perish. Or are we going to partner with Satan, the accuser? The accuser. So either you're in a place of prayer and you're praying for all people to be saved, or you're partnering with Satan and you're accusing. And when you accuse people, you keep them, you condemn them, and condemnation and shame keeps people in their sin. We don't pray shame on you. We pray shame off of you so you can get free. Mm-hmm. And so it's Satan, the accuser of the brethren, that wants to put shame on us. I think our president has tons of flaws, And I'm saddened by how much he uses social media. I don't think he's a racist. I know people that know him personally. He's not a racist. But is he an idiot at times? Yes. Do I enjoy everything that he does? No, I don't. But am I commanded to love him? Yes, I love him. Do I respect him? Yes, I respect him. And I thank God for the beautiful things that he fights for us as Christians. He's fought for things for us as Christians more than any other president that has in decades. And so I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful for that. I wish he'd get a haircut. I'm not big at the whole wave thing, but I love him, and you should love him too, because you're commanded to, and you're commanded to pray for him. I'm concerned where people think that they have a voice to slaughter the innocent, then the only reason they have a voice is because someone didn't slaughter them. I mean, how hypocritical can that possibly be? I'm really concerned because I think a lot of people don't realize that there's a bigger issue going on beyond abortion, and it's starting to come out even, you know, with some of the comments that have been made even recently by the whole issue in Virginia and by the governor a couple weeks ago. Now it's about a week and a half ago, but there's a bigger issue of abortion here. This is about people determining who lives and who dies. And again, this is not something new. So, but this is something that's really, really becoming very pronounced right now, and it's so important that we recognize that we're in a battle as a country, and we need to give voice to some of these things, and the church needs to come together in unity and really start taking a proper stance on this. Our founding fathers, and again, I have spent so many hundreds of hours concerning what makes America. You know, Donald Trump says, let's make America great again. I'm saying, let's make America America again. You know, I want to see America, let's make America God again. You know, our founding fathers, they paid a tremendous price, all of them. I mean, most of them gave up their personal homes, their whole life savings, businesses. I mean, sacrificed their sons and daughters for yours and my freedom, for this country to be birthed. And the incredible sacrifice that our founding fathers, our Christian founding fathers for this nation. And by the way, there's a real radical agenda to erase history in our schools. And if you're not aware of that, I mean, this is not conspiracy stuff. This is factual. This is factual. What's happening in our public school systems today is absolutely horrific. And if you have the ability if you have the unction to be on a school board, you should be on a school board. Every one of us should be active in our community and helping our communities. You know, one of the things that we do as a church is we have the cold weather shelter. Would you please come help on Tuesday nights any of the other nights at the different churches? We had, as you know, we were packed out in the cold weather shelter this last Tuesday night, and I'm so grateful for our team, and our team was amazing, and we actually took people in early and had them stay late, and just loved. And there was more presence of God and peace of God in our cold weather shelter this last Tuesday night than I've ever seen before, And the food was amazing. And so call the office, see Kenda. Kenda's not here in the service right now, but come on, let's give it up for our cold weather shelter team. All you that have been helping. And so it's so important to be involved. Our founding fathers, and again, I've spent hundreds of hours in study on this. One day we're going to have David Barton here. He's one of the most famous historians, Christian historians. One day we're going to have a conference to have David Barton here. I really believe that. And we actually have some friends that know him, and so I believe that we can have David come. Our founding fathers believed this, a priority for our lives: God, then country, then family. They all believe that. They all believe that. God, then country, then family. When I was being raised up in the ministry, early years of the ministry, I always heard God, then family, then ministry, or anything else. The reason why they believed God, then country, then family is because they knew, and based upon their experience and the experience of their fathers and grandfathers and so on and so forth of generations, that if you lose your country and the country is not godly, it will eventually rob and destroy the family. And we're seeing that. We're seeing that. We're seeing where before we removed prayer out of the schools, before we removed the Ten Commandments, before we basically kicked God out of every public arena, before that happened, the family unit was strong in America. And I could give you statistics. Matter of fact, go back in, it was December, I don't know the date. No, it might have been even, no, it was January. January 19th. Bethel Church, how many are familiar with Bethel Church? Chris Volatin preached a message not too long ago, a few weeks ago, at Bethel Church on family and fatherhood. The principles of fatherhood is the name of the message. The principles of fatherhood. January 13th. Thank you, son. Go back. Chris Volatin gives testimony and stats of what has happened to the family over the last 50 years. Okay? And so and what he was sharing is, as your country goes down the tubes and removes God, what it does to destroy families. Families are in such a disarray and dysfunction and broken now more today than ever before. And the statistics of children being born out of wedlock and divorce and I mean, just the list just goes on and on and on. It's absolutely astonishing, completely astonishing. And I encourage you to listen to that message. My point being is this: I believe that many in the church as a whole around the nation has made family, their personal family, a place of idolatry. I know I got quiet last week when I shared this too. And the reason being is because what you compromise to keep, you will eventually lose. When you put your house above God's house, and I'm not talking about the four walls, and I'm not talking about building denominations or anything like that. I'm talking about the kingdom of God. The Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God. It doesn't say seek first building your family or building your home. Let me try this over here. I know it was popular last week too. The Bible does not say seek first you building your home or building your family. It says seek first the kingdom of God. And what we compromise to keep, we will lose. What we compromise to keep, Hezekiah was guilty of this. The prophet says, Hezekiah, you're going to lose Jerusalem and you're going to lose Judea, but you won't lose it in your lifetime. And he goes, well, I guess I won't repent then. I guess we won't change our ways then, because it's not going to happen to me. The Bible says that we should be thinking of an inheritance for our children's children. So what kind of inheritance? I'm not talking about financial inheritance. I'm talking about a God inheritance. What kind of an inheritance are we leaving our children's children? What kind of country are we going to be leaving them? Say, Pastor Keith, this is heavy stuff. No, this is God stuff. We need, listen, Jake's house, we need to be a part of a movement of God. I'm not interested, and you guys know this, those of you that have been around for a long time, if you're new to our family, it's not always like this. Trust me, it's not always like this. We're a very happy, fun-filled people. We are. I mean, we love to party. We love conferences. We love God. We love people. And we believe in the joy of the Lord is pronounced in our lives. And I believe right now I'm ministering out of joy. I wish I was a little bit more happy, but I'm ministering out of joy because I feel so strong about this. The joy of the Lord is our strength. I feel so strong. We need to be a part of a bigger movement that is beyond our little microchasm, little thing that we've got cooking or going on. We've got to be a part of something bigger. And God is calling us to be a part of something bigger. We need to be a part. Listen, not everybody, because of life and family and career and everything, not everybody can contribute at the same level. But come on, give your widow's mite if that's all you can give. And I'm not talking about finances. If you think I'm not talking about finances, that's a part of it. But I'm talking about we need to give ourselves. We need to give ourselves to a movement. We need to give ourselves to a movement of revival and restoration and God blowing and moving on our country again. We need to give ourselves to a movement of saving our children and saving our loved ones. We need to give ourselves to a movement of God. We need to give ourselves to that. We need to give ourselves to our nation being turned around again. And just like our early founding fathers gave so much for America to be established and for America to be built, we need to give ourselves again, back again. We need to give ourselves. We're coming. I'm telling you, I'm writing a book right now, and it's called Full Circle. And I'm telling you, we are coming full circle again in our nation. And we're going to have to give ourselves again to prayer. Some of you may not be able to give in time like you need to. We need to give ourselves in prayer. Some of you, we need to give ourselves in different. We need to give ourselves again to a move. It's not about Jake's house. It's not about the Assemblies of God. It's not about the Church of God or Foursquare or anything. It's about a move of God in our nation. We need to give ourselves to God again, to a movement. And I'm telling you, one of the things that we need to change is we need to repent where we've made our personal home and family idolatry, where we've put our home and our agenda above God's agenda. And that's uncomfortable for all of us, and I get that. I get that. But what we compromise to keep, we will lose. Now, again, our founding fathers, they felt like God, then country, then family. And then, of course, I grew up in the ministry, God, then family, then ministry or country or whatever. Both those patterns are incorrect. Now, God works with, you know, in spite of us, and he does the best that he can to work through our understanding, our revelation. And how many know that we're all continuing to grow in the revelation of God and the kingdom of God? People, I always hear people say, you know, a false balance is an abomination to the Lord. I totally agree with that. But what's a false balance is when you put God over here and family over here, and you know, I grew up in ministry, and it's like, okay, you know, how do you balance those? Or you put family over here and ministry over here, and how do you balance those? Listen, I shared this last week. I have seen so many, and I know you guys have too, seen so many families destroyed because of families or spouses or kids competing with family or ministry. And they were never meant to compete with one another. There was never supposed to be a competition or a comparison. There was never ever supposed to be a competition or comparison of how much do we give to God and how much do we give to country, or how much do we give to family, or how much do we give to God, or how much do we give to ministry and how much do we give to country. That these were never meant to compete with one another and put each one on each opposite scale. They are always meant to be scaled together over here. Because God is not into us competing in these areas. He's into us integrating these areas. I never want to separate my children from the work of God. Well, let's see, what's more important, the work of God or my family? Right? No. That's a false balance. You're never supposed to compete with those, and those are supposed to be integrated. We're not supposed to be battling those things. Does that make sense? They're not supposed to be at war with one another. Does this make sense? And I could teach so much more on that. We just don't have time. I want to conclude with this. There's people speaking out, and last week I talked about the importance of not going out on social media and just voicing your opinion or voicing your anger. There were some people that came to me after the service and said, you know, well, are we just not supposed to go on social media at all? I didn't say that. I just said the Bible teaches that we will give have a stricter judgment. So when you have a platform, whatever platform that may be, if it's public office or whether it's leading the church or whatever mountain sphere of influence God has given you, you're going to get, if you're at the top of that place and you're a leader in that place, you're going to have a stricter account and that's what Scripture teaches. And so all I'm saying is if you go on social media, make sure that you do it right. Because you're going to be judged for those things that you do and say, when being the fact that you have that platform. Should we have righteous anger? Yes, we should. But where should we express it? In the prayer closet. Come on. We shouldn't be judgmental. We shouldn't be angry towards people, and it definitely shouldn't come out on social media. And again, we talked about this. You know, we're not going to partner with Satan, the accuser of the brethren. We're going to partner with Jesus, our high priest, who's making intercession for all mankind. Righteous anger, this is, and I really need you to understand this. Righteous anger is associated with a redemptive story. You need to hear this. You need to get this. Righteous anger is associated with a redemptive story. If you can't see and you don't have an understanding of a redemptive story, you don't have righteous anger. You have human anger. And human anger is destructive. Let me say that again. If you don't have clarity of heart and spirit concerning a redemptive story in this, you don't have righteous anger. You have humanistic anger, which is the Bible. James 3 says it's evil and it's demonic. Be careful when you get angry. That you know that it's righteous anger. How do I know that it's righteous anger? Because there's clarity of heart that there's a redemptive story that you're fighting for. If you don't have clarity of heart and spirit concerning a redemptive story, you don't have righteous anger. It's humanistic anger, and it's devilish, and it's demonic. And we just need to repent of it. We've all been there. Come on. I'm just giving you Scripture, what James says. So we've all been there. Look, this is really important. Righteous anger, this is in your notes, towards injustice can be very helpful if used correctly. Righteous anger towards injustice. For example, babies being murdered, that's an injustice. Righteous anger towards injustice can be very helpful if used correctly. How can it be used correctly? Well, again, not towards people, but towards the injustice. Did you catch that? Not towards the people, but towards the injustice. Anger, righteous anger, can be very creative. Listen to me. Righteous anger can be very creative. How many have just been super angry before in a righteous way and God started giving you downloads about how the situation can change? Come on. Righteous anger can be very creative. It can be very creative. It can lead to creative ideas. In your notes here, righteous anger then can create powerful people, not victims and not powerless people. Righteous anger can actually empower you to be a powerful person. Why? Because you have clarity concerning a redemptive story. You have ideas that are coming. God has given you God ideas to change the situation. And there's motivation. God's given you supernatural motivation to change something. Come on, amen? Righteous anger can be a powerful, powerful tool if known what it is and used correctly. Praise the Lord. And then we got a big amen back there. Somebody's righteously angry right now. I think it's something about food or something. I don't know. Or it's like, Pastor Keith, you've gone past your time and I'm righteously hungry right now. I know. Forgive me. Just two more minutes. In your notes here, human anger leads to offense, and offense leads to bitterness. This is in your Bible, Hebrews chapter 12, 12 through 15. Bitterness defiles many. It's a horrible cancer. People that are just going on social media because they're offended, they're spreading bitterness, and they're spreading offense, and it's like cancer, and it's so destructive. There are Christians, I didn't put this scripture in your notes, I'm just quoting this, 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2 talks about God's people being snared by the devil through bitterness or offense and being used by Satan. How many have ever been used by Satan before? The rest of you are lying. The rest of you that did not put up your hands, you're lying. And we will cast that lying spirit out. Every one of us have been used by Satan because of offense and because of bitterness, and we were used by him as a pawn. And I'm telling you, there are too many people that are going on social media and being used by Satan. Good people, godly people being used by Satan because it's not righteous anger, it's humanistic anger. Is this good? Is this okay? All right. Finally, this is what you can do is don't have offense, don't have bitterness, okay? That's a horrible cancer that will be destructive. Don't be offensive, but go on the offense and prophesy. Start prophesying life. Start prophesying life to the dry bones. Start prophesying revival to our nation. Start prophesying and come up with a new press. Have a new press. Elijah rebuilt the altar. The Bible says that Elijah rebuilt the altar in prayer. And what happened is God gave him a voice. God gave him a voice at the top of the mountain. God will give you a voice at the top of your mountain. Come on. And start prophesying and declaring the word of the Lord. Quit partnering with Satan with shame and guilt and condemnation and start prophesying the life of God over our nation. Start prophesying the life of God over our government that things begin to change. Let's have a new press and let's have that spirit of Elijah start declaring from the people of God. And I wish I had more time. There's some great things in here about platform. Listen, in the very beginning, everybody said the beginning. In the beginning, God used prophecy and declaration. He spoke a word into existence and it created. Then Isaiah prophesied that He prophesies that there would come light and word that would come again, that would declare, that would change a nation. And then Ezekiel talks about it. And then all of a sudden the church is born. And guess how the church is born? The church is born out of prophecy and declarations. And the church begins to declare a thing or two, just like what Job says. And God has called us. This is what ecclesia in the Greek means. Ecclesia means to declare. It means governmental declaration. That's what ecclesia means. It means the purpose, the church, this is who we are. We are people for the purpose of gathering for a public decree or a public declaration. That's why you exist. That's why the Spirit of God, you have the Spirit of God, is to stand up on your mountain and declare the love of God and declare the freedom of Christ and declare, come on, amen, life over our nation and life over you. Amen. That's you were born into the kingdom. You were born into the church to have governmental authority to declare. And so don't use your tongue. Do not use your tongue to bring death, but use your tongue to speak life in Jesus' name. Well, we're way over, but we're having just one service today, and we're having fun in the snow, and let's all stand. Come on, let's give the Lord a shout and praise. And forgive me if anyone has thought that, you know, there's any kind of agenda or motive. My heart, please, everybody, please hear me. My heart is in one place and one place only, and that is to see our nation have the greatest move of God. And where it gets darkest, it's going to get the brightest. And our nation is not going to hell in a handbasket. Our nation is coming back to God. Our nation is coming back to God. Our nation is coming back to God. And so... please forgive me if you think that I have any other agenda. I have one agenda and one agenda only. It's the same agenda of Jesus. It's His will that none should perish, that none should be separated from God, that none should have eternity in hell, that all would be saved and all would come into relationship with Jesus Christ and know the love of the Father. Come on, someone give me a big amen. And If you're here today and you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ and you don't understand the price that He paid for your sin, He loves you, God loves you, and you can be born today of love. You can be born of love, and love can forever change you and transform you, and that's God's heart for everyone on the planet, regardless of where they're at in life or what color of skin or what background they have or how young or how old. God loves everyone, and it's His desire that none should perish. And so in the name of Jesus, I just declare a freedom in this place. If you're backslidden, you've been away from God, and this is an opportunity for you to say yes to Jesus. If you want to say yes to God and you've never said yes to the Lord before, or you want to come back to Him, would you just meet me here at the altar? Just meet me here at the altar. If you want to come back to the Lord or you want to say yes to Him for the first time, just meet me here at the altar. I believe that there's a couple more people, and I just want to take a moment as a church family. Come on, family. Is this okay? Is this all right? Anybody else? You want to come back to the Lord? You want to come back to the Lord, or you want to give your heart to Him? Anybody else? Just meet me here at the altar. Amen. Pastor Judy, would you come and stand with this precious lady here? Oh, come on. See, I knew there's some holdouts out there. Come on, sweetie. Come on. Let me. Kim, Jenny, someone come and stand with this precious young lady here. Come on. Anybody else? Anybody else? Any other Holy Spirit holdouts? Church family, would you extend your hands towards these two precious ladies? Lord, we say yes. We say yes to You. We have a big yes in our hearts to You, God. And we surrender our lives to You. It's not about fancy prayers, lady. It's just a simple yes in your heart. It's just a simple surrender to Jesus. And Father, we just say yes. We say yes to You, God. We say yes. God, I ask right now for the love of Papa to cover you. May you be born of love, born of love, born of love. And that love just drive out all fear. We just command all fear to go and for love to come, for God to come right now, for him to come. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. If you've been marked, we did this last week. If you've been marked by abortion, if you've been marked by abortion in any way, and there's just been, or you know someone that has, and you just want someone to receive prayer, we want to pray for you that there's no shame, there's no guilt, that God begins to heal you and heal your family. And so, so in the name of Jesus, we just open up these altars here, and we just speak freedom right now. And so if you've been marked by abortion in any way and you'd like to have prayer, we would love to pray for you. We'd love to pray for you. We're just going to continue to worship. God bless you. Please be safe this week. Also, call the office to find out about schedule, when the church will be open and what our schools will be doing. Make sure you hug someone and greet someone. God bless you. We love you. Thank you so much for worshiping with us.